Before I need you, Lord, I than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, more than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never wanna go back to my old life. I need you more, more than yesterday. I need you more, more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. More than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, more than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never wanna go back to my old life. I need you more, more than yesterday. I need you more, more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. We give you the highest praise.
We give you, Lord, the highest.
We give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. Oh, I need you more. Oh, more than yesterday. I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you more. More than yesterday, I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord.
Thank you.
most beautiful among thousands and thousands. My beloved is the most beautiful among thousands and thousands. My beloved is the most beautiful. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Jesus, you deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve.
Welcome to Reclaim San Antonio. Please go ahead and turn around and greet each other.
Well, hello and good morning, church. Welcome again to Reclaim San Antonio. We're glad to have you guys with us today. Amen. It's good to get excited. We're in the house of the Lord this morning. If it's your first time here, you're our honored guest. We welcome you. Thank you for joining us. You should have received a welcome gift on the way in and a connect card. If you haven't, if you can raise your hand, we'll get that to you. And if you need that card, if you fill it out, you can either hand it to one of us or put it in the offering basket, which will be up here in a second. Unless I just don't see it. So I'm just going to go over some quick announcements before I take up the offering. Last week was like the second best day of the year. No, it was a Mother's Day. We had a great time celebrating and honoring all the moms. So we had a good time. So thank you everyone who came out. Thank you for everyone who helped. We hope every mother that came was blessed and just felt just extra special that day. And so... So that was last Sunday. And Wednesday, we have our worship and prayer, which is here at 7 p.m. If you can join us, we pray for our church. We pray for individual needs. And it's just a special time in the Holy Spirit. And as you guys know, we have our Reach Texas conference coming up. That's May 26th to the 28th. Yes, exciting time too. We do need volunteers for that. If you are able to help, let us know. Additionally, what we're doing as a church, as the body of Christ here, we're fasting Wednesdays. You know, we have our prayer and our worship and prayer, so we're fasting on Wednesdays in anticipation of what's going to happen in our conference. So after worship and prayer, we've been, you know, if you want, you can break your fast after that or keep on going. But join us. I encourage you guys to join us for what God's doing in this ministry and what He's doing in this church. So that's Wednesdays. Next Sunday, also May 22nd, if you are volunteering or helping out in any way with the conference, there's a volunteer meeting that's being held up in Hutto. That's where the conference will be too. Sorry, I forgot to mention that. But we will be having a meeting for all the volunteers next Sunday. It's at 6 p.m. You know, find someone else who's helping out, who's volunteering, you know, carpool. But there will be a meeting for everyone who's volunteering that day next Sunday. Saturday morning prayers at 8:30. We meet here in the sanctuary. So if you can join us for that, that's Saturday mornings at 8:30. And then next month is another special holiday. June 19th, it's Father's Day. So yeah. Yay. So every dad in attendance will receive a free gift. And so we'll be having food, and it'll be a time of fellowship. So, you know, invite someone. Invite someone who's a dad. Invite, you know, encourage someone to come to church with you that day. So, hallelujah. God is good. Let's go ahead and give Him some praise as we get ready to receive an offering. If you need an envelope, we do have those. You can raise your hand and we'll get one to you. We do have multiple ways to give up on the screen right here. So we have those ways to give. We do prefer the Zelle only because we avoid costs and fees. You know, these days we're charged for everything. Those small percentages add up. So Zelle is a way that we avoid them. So, but if however you feel, you know, to give, we'll receive it either way. So if you do need an envelope, raise your hand. We can get one to you. And then I wanted to read out of Malachi chapter 3, which is a popular verse, I think, for this time of offering, but I'm going to go ahead and read it, starting at verse 6. It says, I, the Lord, do not change. So you, the descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed. Ever since the time of your ancestors, you have turned away from my decrees and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. But you ask, how are we to return? Will a mere mortal rob God? Yet you rob me. But you ask, how are we robbing you? In tithes and offerings, you are under a curse, your whole nation, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your fields will not drop their fruit before it is ripe, says the Lord Almighty. Then all the nations will call you blessed. For yours will be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty. I'm skipping down to verse 16. It says, then those who feared the Lord talked with each other, and the Lord listened and heard. A scroll of remembrance was written in his presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. On the day when I act, says the Lord Almighty, they will be my treasured possession. I will spare them, just as a father has compassion and spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. Amen. Oftentimes when I've come across this verse, I kind of skip everything, the part where it says, who will rob God, yet you robbed me. And the thing that catches my attention is the part where he's talking about, you know, this is a back and forth conversation, right? And the Lord, it says that he's listening, he's hearing, you know, his children talking back and forth about this, like how we've robbed God, you know, what does he have that I can steal kind of thing. And they're just going back and forth. And it says that he listened and he heard. And not just that, but he wrote it down. He had it written down. I'm imagining the names, the moments that the people who feared him, he remembered who they were. And we know, some of us who know, you know, the Bible, know in the book of Job, how God bragged on Job, how he was faithful. He loved the Lord. He served God. God brags on people. And I got to thinking at one point, like, wow, when it comes to my giving, am I the kind of giver that the Lord, you know, brags about? Does he remember me? Or does he remember me as the one who holds back? You know, that's my daughter who doesn't really trust me. I know, you know, she cares more about, you know, buying shoes, you know, about, you know, her Starbucks drink. She puts me second, you know. We know where our money goes, right? If we look at our bank, you know, I don't know if all of us have checkbooks still, but if we look at where the money's, you know, being sent out of our bank account, we know where it goes. And I don't want to be remembered for all the shoes I had, all the Starbucks trips I made, you know. I want to be remembered for, well, you know, she sowed into the kingdom. She sowed into what God was doing, because that's what was important. And the other thing, in verse 10, it says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Oftentimes, we refer to the storehouse as the church. And yes, naturally, it does take finances to you know, what goes on here for you guys to see it. There's a building, there's lights, there's electricity, there's air conditioning. It does take finances. So yes, naturally, this is a storehouse. If you consider this your home church, you should be giving. You should be giving a tithe, an offering, sowing into what's happening here. This is where you're being fed. But also, I think there's a storehouse that's being built up for us, because the Bible, God says that he blesses those who give. His covenant is with the giver. It's not with the person who holds back. The covenant he made is with the giver. And he says in that day that he'll remember them, that they will be his treasured possession, that he will remember, that there will, people will see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not, between the giver and the thief, if you think about it, right? So I just want to encourage you guys to you know, give out of your heart, give because the Lord tells us to give. I'm going to go ahead and pray. But again, if you need an envelope or if you need, you know, reminders of how to give, these are the ways right here. So Lord, we just thank you, God. We thank you for the opportunity to, God, just to give back to you, just a portion, God, of what you've given to us, Lord. We know, God, that all things are yours, God. And I just pray, God, that our hands would never be closed over anything that you've given us, God, but that we would open them up and give freely back to you, God, because we love you, God, because you are our Father, God, and you've given just so much of yourself, Lord God. And I pray, God, that every person who gives today, God, that you will bless them, God, that you will multiply every blessing towards them, God, because you are faithful and true to your word, Lord God. And I thank you, God, for what you're doing in this ministry, for what you're doing in each individual, Lord. We love you and we praise you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Amen. Can we give the Lord some praise? Amen. Today, thank you for that. Thank you for your liberality and just your trust in what God is doing through Reclaim San Antonio and this ministry. He's doing an amazing thing. As some of you know, we got started about a year and a half ago during a pandemic when everybody was shutting down across the world, across the country, and God really stirred my heart to say, let's go forward because my people need to hear my voice. They need to hear me. They need to be with each other because we're not created to be in isolation. And so thank you for joining us today. Amen. And so I just want to thank everybody for being here. I know that, you know, there's other places you can be, but on Sunday morning, you come to spend time with the Lord. and your brothers and sisters. I just wanted to share one more announcement as I get started today. I'm not sure if she mentioned it. I had to use the restroom, so I ran to the restroom real quick. But on Thursdays, we have an incredible opportunity to outreach to our youth. And last week, my wife and I, we made some time and we went over to Churchill High School because that's the high school right next door to us. Met the principal and other people there. They were excited that somebody from church wanted to come talk to their youth, because there's a lot of kids in there, no matter what age, that are broken inside. In the outside there's a smile, but in the inside there's a brokenness. Maybe they're from a single parent family home. There's different reasons. Some of them are dabbling in drugs and they're starting to go the wrong path. But we want to share that there's good news and there's hope. And how will they know unless we tell them? And so we had a great opportunity to do that. And the principal said, I think his name is Mr. Bloomer, but he had said, a great way to reach the youth is right after school. They get off about 4:20 and they walk across the street to the Valero station there and the Taco Bell and the KFC. And they kind of hang out. They're either waiting to be picked up from their parents or they have nowhere else to go. So they're just kind of hanging out with their friends. And so we had a few guys go out there on Thursday. Right away, a few guys go out there and just share the love of Christ, that there's hope. And at first they were a little standoffish, you know, like, you know, who are these, you know, men over here? And all of a sudden, I guess God's word goes forth and they started to ask questions, or maybe they've been hurt by church before or what didn't meet their expectation. But I'm going to get into this message and then I'm going to share a little bit about testimony. And so just bear with me as I get started today. The title of my sermon today is The Choice is Yours. The choice is yours. How many know we have free will? And so I titled that, and I really want to dive in because of what we've been doing the past few weeks right after Easter. And you know, we know that Jesus is the risen King. He is the one true living God. And we started talking about testimony because that's what the disciples did. They shared their testimony of spending time with Jesus. It wasn't their opinion. It wasn't something they heard. They actually spent time, so they shared their testimony of their experience with the Messiah. And so our main text today, if you're going to take notes, it's out of Acts chapter 24, and I'm just going to share some of that. But before I get there, I'm going to share something else. But Acts chapter 24 is the main text, verses 22 to 27. And I'll come back to there just in a few moments. But we've been talking about personal testimonies. And the reality is that every person here, doesn't matter your age, has a testimony. You have a story. Whatever has influenced you in your life, whatever has happened to you in your past, you have a testimony. You have something to share about your life. You have something that you've experienced in your life that you can share. And so when you come to the Lord, when you're saved, your testimony shifts and your perspective shifts. So all of a sudden, you're not just talking about who you are, but you're talking about who He is. And you're talking about what He did for you. So it's powerful. And so when you come to the Lord, your perspective changes on things. And I say that because if in the past, you say, Pastor, I was an angry person. Well, can I say now you could be angry at the devil? In the past, you could say, Pastor, I was stubborn. Can I say now be stubborn for your faith? Can I say, oh, Pastor, I was streetwise. Well, now can you be streetwise and outreach to the community that's lost? Come on now, somebody. Come on. In the past, Pastor, you don't know me. In the past, I had to surrender to the police. Amen. Can you surrender to Jesus now? Come on, we can get going. It doesn't matter who you were in the past. It matters who you are now in Christ. And so don't give up. Don't be, if you were a strong man in the world, if you were confident and nothing bothered you, nothing made you scared, all of a sudden you come to the kingdom of God and now you're like, oh, I can't do that. I can't go out there. What are they going to say to me? The reality is your nature doesn't change. Your perspective does. And when you allow the Holy Spirit to come in you, you use His strength, not yours. Amen? Amen? Come on, somebody. Come on, let's give Him some praise. He's good. There's power in testimony. We've been talking about that because there's so many things that testimony does, not for you, but for who you're speaking to. First of all, it bears witness to Christ. And I shared this verse last time. I said Revelations 1:9. It says, I, John, both your brother and companion in the tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was on the island that's called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. See, your testimony points people to Jesus, not you. Also, when you do that, it shows your love for Christ. It shows your love for Christ. In 2 Timothy 1:8, it should be up there on the screen, it says, therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God. See, if you love Christ, you share Jesus. If you have the love of God in you, you have to share. You have to love your brother, even when they backstab you, even when they turn their back on you. You have to love your brother. When Christ is in you, when Holy Spirit comes in you, you share that. You can't help yourself. You want them to know what God has done for you. You want them to know you were once here, now you're here. Maybe you don't understand it, but you're different somehow. With your testimony, it brings others to Christ. Can I tell you that the Bible says that one plants and one waters, but only Christ brings the increase. So I run into people sometimes, they say, oh, I went and I saved all these people for the Lord. But the thing is that they would say, they're in church because of me. Actually, they're not. They're in church because the Holy Spirit drew them. And so I share that with you. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 10. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 10. When he comes in that day to be glorified in his saints and to be admired among all those who believe, because our testimony among you was believed. When you share your testimony, seeds are planted. When you share your testimony, somebody needed to hear that. So speak loud. I know there's times I'm in public and I'm speaking to somebody, and I'm speaking loud because I know somebody can hear me. And you know what? I can't tell you how many times, and I've been with brothers and sisters talking about at a Starbucks, talking to somebody about the Lord, and somebody said, oh man, thank you for sharing that. I received that. Or I prayed for somebody at Starbucks. I was in Florida a couple weeks ago. I was praying for this person on the phone. I was outside Starbucks because I was praying loud, and I was just praying the blood of Jesus over, and there was a person, I didn't realize this, in a car sitting next to me. And after I finished, I walked in, I felt good. Oh, God's going to touch her. God's going to help her. I know this. I went in, met with my uncle inside Starbucks, and this lady came in crying. And she's like, oh, man, you were praying for somebody on the phone, but that was for me. Can you pray for me? Because she heard my prayer. Because she heard the word of the Lord going forth, she got touched. Come on, somebody. And another thing, your personal testimony, it gives victory over the enemy. It gives you victory over the enemy. Revelations 12:11. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to death. You see, when you share your testimony and you pray the blood of the Lamb over somebody, when you share the word of your testimony, it touches people. It plants seeds, it waters, but mostly it draws them into what Christ is doing. There's power in your testimony, not because it's your opinion, not because you believe it, it's because you've experienced it and you've shared it, amen? How many know it's not about us, it's about Jesus? Right. How many know it's not about your strength or your power, but his? Zechariah 4:6 says, Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. I'm telling you, sometimes people say, I'm not strong enough. You're not. It has to be the Holy Spirit. Some people say, you know what, this walk is too hard. I can't do this walk. You're right, on your power you can. You have to pray, you have to read, you have to come to church with other like-minded believers that want to intercede with you and believe God for you. You know what happens when we link our hearts? The Bible says, don't forsake the gathering of the brethren. You know why? That's how we're encouraged. There are times when you're going to come in, you're not going to feel it. You're not going to feel like raising your hands. You're not going to feel like talking to anybody. But when you come, I can tell you this, I've never, even when I haven't felt like coming, there's never been a time where I said, I shouldn't have went to church today. Every time I go, something happens. Every time I go, do not let this place become dull to you. Do not come in and say, oh, it's the same old thing. It's not. It's how you receive it. It's your choice on how to receive it. And so come in ready. Come in with high expectations. I know God's going to move in my life. I know he's heard my prayer. I'm going to go in and see what he has for me because I want all he has for me today. Amen. The word of God tells us to share the good news. How many know that? Mark chapter 16, verse 15. Come on. It's going to be up there. Amen. Is it? I guess I was too fast. Sorry, Liz. And then he told them, go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone. Why do we share our testimony? First of all, because the Bible commands us to. Because there's power in his word and people need to hear it. See, today, I feel like a lot of us, we lose our sense of urgency because we're comfortable. You're saved, praise the Lord. Those that know the Lord have received, praise the Lord. But a lot of times we get comfortable. It gets comfortable knowing with a confidence that you have eternity with Jesus. But the reality is that you know people that are not saved. You know people that are not going to heaven. You know people that refuse to hear what God has to say. And see, whether you believe it or not, this world is dying. Whether you believe it or not, this world is dying. We live in a fallen world where there's no hope. We live in an imperfect world with imperfect people making imperfect decisions. That should give you all the answers when somebody offends you. They're imperfect and they make imperfect decisions, but we have the answer. We have the answer. It's almost selfish of us not to share the word of God. You're keeping it to yourself. We keep it to ourselves. We need to tell our families. We need to tell our loved ones. We need to tell all those that we know, our coworkers, even your enemy. Tell them there's hope. Tell them there's an answer. Tell them they're not alone. Tell them Jesus loves them. Tell them. And you know who's most vulnerable at this? Is our youth. The next generation is so vulnerable right now. They're so vulnerable because unless we tell them, how will they know? That's why we want to reach the community. We want to reach everyone here that doesn't know Jesus. We want to go out there and be loud. Jesus loves them. There's hope. There are families right now, broken families, drug-addicted families. There are people can't make it financially. So much right across the street, to the left, to the right. They're everywhere. They're sitting at home saying, what am I going to do? I have the answer. What am I going to do? And most vulnerable right now, because those same kids in those families, they're looking to their parents for answers. In the schools, They're looking for something, some understanding from the teachers, the adults over, and they're looking, they're waiting. What do we do? And what do they tell them? Oh, just study hard. Study hard, you'll get a job, and you'll be fine. Is that the reality? Has anybody went through a financial problem? Come on. So some of you know, and not to boast or brag, but I have a master's degree in business and theology, and I know the word of God, but can I tell you I've struggled financially? My perspective shifted, though. I was like, hallelujah, this is a recipe for a miracle. And God came through again. He did it again like he always does. And so I share that because right now, out the next generation, how will they know? See, adults, we kind of do our thing. Adults, I can decide to go to church or not. I'll go. If I feel it, I'm going to go to church. The kids are at the mercy of their parents. A young kid can't come. They won't come unless their parent says, okay, let's go. Because if a kid says, I want to go to church, well, you don't know who's over there. There might be some weird people in there. You don't want to go there. So the children are at the mercy of their parents. But we have a school right here. We have a school everywhere around here. And so I went over there. I said, you know what? There are some young teens, whatever they are, 12, 13, 14, 15, up to adult age. Tell them there's somewhere they can go after school. Let their parents know they have somewhere to go after school instead of hanging out at a gas station or a convenience store. Tell them there's a place to go. So we said on Thursdays, we're going to go reach them. And I'm going to call my brother Robert up here. Amen. Oscar, can you get that mic? I told him I might call him up, so... But the reason why I want to call him up is because when Robert came to us, he has a heart for evangelism, a heart for outreach. And all I did was mention that I went to the school and there's an opportunity. He said, when are we going? When are we going? I'm like, oh, we haven't planned that yet. He goes, when can we go? I said, well, Thursday they're going to be. And he grabbed some flyers and went. And I want him to share what happened when he went out there. Amen.
You guys hear me? All right, cool. Just like Pastor said, the principal opened up a door for us, and I hit up McKenzie. I was like, yo, like, let's go talk to these kids. So we show up, and right away, we're getting persecuted. A lot of hurt kids from religion, they had never experienced God. They've only experienced the rules and regulations of church. So they had a lot of anger and a lot of animosity, but the anointing of God came upon us. The love of God for their soul came upon us, and we were just accepting their criticism, their backlash, and when they finally let us get to speak, you know, God, when you go out, God will give you the words to speak to them. He'll speak to you prophetically, and you won't even know that you're speaking prophetically. And we started speaking to the hearts of these kids. We started speaking to the root of their issues. We started speaking to their bitterness. And the ones that were really persecuting us ended up being the ones that really got moved. God really touched their heart. There was this one girl in particular, she had piercings on her nose, and she was like, if God is real, how come he let me go through this? How come he let me go through this and this and that? And I just shared with her. I was like, you know what? God has never left you. He's never been deaf. He's never turned a deaf ear to your prayers. And I was like, God, Jesus didn't, he didn't, He didn't leave you defenseless. He lived everything that he expected you to live through. He lived through betrayal. He lived through persecution. He lived through poverty. At one time, he was homeless. You know, like, he's lived through these things, and he's called you to endure these things. He didn't promise you an easy life. He promised you a life of faith, a life of love, a life of experiencing God's power and his miraculous. And by the time we got done speaking to her, she was, like, almost in tears. And she was like, thank you. Like, thank you for coming out here. Thank you for speaking to us. And, like, multiple kids, all the ones that were hating us the most, they were, God's Spirit touched them. God's Spirit revealed the love of Christ to them. And they understood that having faith in God is not just, it's not an easy life, but it's a life worth living. And so we're going to keep going out there. We're going to keep reaching these kids. And I believe that all these kids are going to, you know, the Bible says that God chooses the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. These kids are the troublemakers of the school. Their principal knows about them, but God's going to touch their hearts. God's going to move in them. God's going to use them to reach the rest of the kids. And, you know, and it's going to be for God's glory. It's going to be for the glory of Jesus Christ. And the school is going to know that surely there's a God in heaven who answers prayer. Surely there's a God in heaven who can transform the life. And he's going to use these kids, man. And we're going to sit there and we're going to watch them. But we need disciplers. We need men and women like you that are going to, they're going to lay down your life on the altar and say, God, use me. You're going to put away the idols. You're going to put away the idols of the Raiders, the Lakers, all these different things. You're going to put away these idols and say, God, fill me with your word. Fill me with your spirit so I can go forth and pour into this generation. God, use me. I'll pray. I'll fast. I'll read your word. I'll preach your word. God, use my life. And it's going to be you guys. You guys are the leaders of this generation coming up. So,
amen,
yeah, praise God.
Amen. You can keep talking. Okay. Praise the Lord. And you see, just from God put it in my heart to go to this school, and all of a sudden he goes out there, and they go out there, and then, and the principal even told me, he goes, hey, I'm just warning you, those are not our best kids out there. And I'm like, that's okay, we'll go out there. And so what we're going to do, what we're planning, is a Thursday outreach. They're there at 4:30, so we'll be there 4:45, 5 o'clock. And what we're going to do we've told them we're going to barbecue right up front. We're going to make some hamburgers and hot dogs. So after school, if they're hungry, come over here, and we're just going to love on them. And then as we go into summer, we want to do summer youth nights. And whether it's a movie, whether it's games, whether it's video games, we're going to do something because we know they're hungry. They're looking for something. And we have the answer. Amen. Outreach is so important. Outreach is so important. And that's why I say when people tell me, I just don't feel comfortable because I don't know the word of God that well. Okay, but you know your testimony. You know what God has done for you. And now's the time. We need a sense of urgency. The lost is lost. And we need to share the good news. Amen? Amen. And one of my favorite evangelists, even when I got saved about 16, 17 years ago, I used to love watching Billy Graham. I used to love watching Billy Graham because I'm like, man, he's so confident in what he's saying. I'd love to do that one day. And even when I wasn't a believer, I loved the way he spoke. It was such conviction with power. But he always ended, you need to make a decision. You're not promised tomorrow. Oh, he's not begging. He's just telling them it's your choice. And so I'm going to share a short video. If you don't know who he is, you're going to know him because whether it was on a hillside, whether it was in a tent, whether it was on the TV or radio, whether it was a few people or thousands, he preached the same message to make a decision. Amen. So I'm going to share this video right now. And can you dim the lights back there, Hugo? And we're going to watch this together. Amen.
God said there's coming a day when I'm going to shake the world. But some things will not be shaken. Some things remain. In other words, there's coming a time when the world will be pressed and there'll be no way out. Those times come in your life, in your home. Tension, friction, financial trouble. You're pressed and there doesn't seem to be a way out. There is an answer. There is a way. Jesus said, I am the way. But in the midst of all this changing, there's some things that never change. Think of it a moment. What never changes? The nature of God doesn't change.
Come on, that's powerful. Come on, you can give God some praise. Amen. The choice is yours. The choice is yours. See, the key to what Billy Graham was, it was the effectiveness of it. The effectiveness was it, was there was no delay in it. Why delay what God has given you? The call was, it was immediate. It was urgent. I remember watching that, and I'm like, I don't know who God is. I don't know about Jesus, but I feel something's calling me. I wanted to know more. And crusade after crusade, you heard of thousands of people giving their lives to the Lord. And he always shared a message of urgency. It was so powerful because tomorrow is promised to no one. It reminds me of Joshua. And if you're familiar with his story in Joshua 24, when he's talking to the people of Israel, God's people, he's telling them, you need to choose for yourselves. I can't choose for you. Nobody can choose for you. It's your personal decision. And I'm sure he's upset because God delivered them from Egypt. He delivered them from slavery and bondage, from where they were at. And he said, you need to choose. Put away the idols. Put away all those things that you're praying to. Choose God. Choose God. Let me read that for you in Joshua chapter 24, verse 14. He starts off by saying, fear the Lord and serve him. Joshua 24, 14. So fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols your ancestors worshipped when they lived beyond the Euphrates River in Egypt. Serve the Lord alone. He's saying, listen, God delivered you from oppression. He delivered you from bondage. He delivered you from torment. He delivered you from slavery, the things you hated the most. He delivered you. Now where are you? You're free to choose, and you choose other things. I imagine the urgency in his voice. Like, what are you doing? Can I tell you, church, sometimes pastors can feel that way. When people come to church and they leave and they're gone, what are you doing? You were so happy. God was moving in your life. You stopped doing drugs. You stopped drinking. Oh, you got restored in a way that you thought you couldn't do. Your kids came back to you. You were restored with your kids. All these things were happening. Now you're not hurting, but now you're not in church. God delivered you from slavery. God delivered you from bondage. He delivered you from your past, the mind games, the overthinking, the wildness in our mind. You say, Pastor, my mind is so loud. But God quiets it for you. And now I'm okay. I feel good. See you later, Pastor. I'll come back. You have to choose. You have to choose. And when he says fear the Lord, it's not fear. Don't be afraid of God, but fear being without him. He's the one. He's the way, the truth, and the life. He's the one that gives you peace the world doesn't understand. He's the one that comes upon you and gives you rest. He's the one that restores your life and your marriage. He's the one that delivers from alcohol, drugs, any bondage. He breaks the chain. He breaks it. He doesn't break it so you can be free and leave. He breaks it so you can be free and choose him. The choice is yours. Joshua continues. He continues. But if you refuse, he's telling them right now. He's giving them an ultimatum in verse 15. But if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods of ancestors serve beyond the Euphrates? Or will it be the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now live? But as for me and my family, come on. As for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. That sounded better in my mind. Praise the Lord. I was like, yeah, serve the Lord for me and my family. Come on, I felt that. Woo. When I was writing this, the Lord was saying, yes, preach it. Come on, Pastor, preach it. For me and my family, we will serve the Lord. We may teach. Come on. Young kids, for me and my generation, we will serve the Lord. We're going to go reach the next generation so they can serve the Lord and know who Jesus is. Amen. Amen. Proverbs 9:10 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Understanding. But for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. Listen, church, we need to live with that urgency. Choose this day whom you will serve. Is it the drugs and alcohol that you run to? Is it the old stuff you used to do? Is the past calling you still? Are you going back there because you remember the good times and you forget all the bad times? What's calling you today? because you need to choose this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my family, because if you refuse for me and my family, we're not going to choose that. We're going to choose to serve the Lord. Amen? What holds you back, church? What holds you? You might be saved and amen, I praise the Lord. You know who Jesus is. You're saved and you feel good. Amen. You're on the mountaintop praising hallelujah. Jesus, you are the risen King. But in the valley, do you still say that? Because the problem is sometimes as believers, how many know we're not perfect? As believers, sometimes there's somebody we need to forgive. As believers, sometimes we need to tell people we love them. As believers, we need to get things off our chest that we hold down deep inside because we haven't given it to the Lord. There are things that will hold you back as a believer from receiving all that God has for you because you don't go to an outreach. Because you don't go to church on Sunday and you miss something God has for you. There's a person that's broken, hypothetically, maybe not. Person that's broken comes to church and they just don't know what to do. And God was going to use you to speak to their lives. And you decide, oh, I'm going to go to the game today. I go to church every Sunday. And you don't come, and that person that you're supposed to talk to doesn't get talked to. See, God has a plan for each and every one of us, whether you understand it or not. He has a plan for you. Is there something that's delaying your decision? A decision you have to make. Can I tell you, any decision you make, when you say, I don't know what to do, can you choose God? When you don't know what to do with your decision, can you put him first and say, Lord, what? I need to do this, but I need you to help me make that decision. So many people say, I tried to do this. I had a decision. I just did it. I go, did you pray? Well, God will work it out. Can I tell you, you can make a bad decision and God will go with you with that bad decision. He'd be like, I told you. And you take the long road. Come on. When you delay decision, when you delay things like that and you start to procrastinate, it'll rob you from your life. It'll rob you from your children. It'll rob you from the things you love. It will keep you from the things of God and what he has for you. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 2 says, for he says, in the time of my favor I heard you, and in the day of salvation I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor, and now is the day of salvation. Now is the day. Now is the day. And sometimes we get comfortable as a believer and say, I gave my life to the Lord 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 5 years ago. I'm good. But then we allow the world to influence us the wrong way. Do you die to yourself daily? Do you pick up your cross daily? Those are the things. When Jesus says this, as he says, now is the day of salvation. The word of God says this. Now is the day of salvation. It's so important that you know who you are. That you're a child of God with a mission that he's given you. To go out and share the good news. Share it with your neighbor. Share it with your loved ones. Share it with people that don't like you. Share it with them. Hebrews chapter 3, 7, 8 says, so as the Holy Spirit says, today, hear me now, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the wilderness. In your struggle, in your valley, don't harden your heart so that you won't hear God. You will hear his voice. But in your hardness of your heart, you'll choose another. And it's funny because I said the main text of my message was Acts chapter 24. And it's actually towards the end of my message. Amen. So I saved it for last. And it's very important. This can resonate with all of us, either you or somebody you know. And so it's about a governor, the Roman governor, that was speaking to Paul when Paul was in prison. And he missed his opportunity. And the Bible's not clear at the end, but it does say that he told Paul to go away. Let me show you. Acts chapter 24, verse 22. It's going to be up here. So read this with me. This is Felix, the Roman governor in this time when Paul's in prison. It says in verse 22, Acts 24, verse 22. At that point, Felix, who was quite familiar with the way, adjourned the hearing and said, wait until Lysias, the garrison commander, arrives. Then I will decide the case. He ordered an officer to keep Paul in custody, but to give him some freedom and allow his friends to visit him and take care of his needs. A few days later, Felix came back with his wife, Drusilla, who was Jewish. Sending for Paul, they listened as he told them about faith in Christ Jesus, as he reasoned with them about righteousness and self-control and the coming day of judgment. Felix became afraid. "Go away for now," he replied. "When it is more convenient, I'll call you again." He also hoped that Paul would bribe him, so he sent for him quite often and talked with him. After 2 years went by in this way, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus. And because Felix wanted to gain favor with the Jewish people, he left Paul in prison. He was replaced when he had access to Paul. See, it was a missed opportunity for him because the Roman governor was there. He understood what the way was. He understood about Jesus, what was going on, the talk of what was going on. And he called for Paul and listened to him. And as he shared his faith in Christ, he shared all these things. He talked about righteousness, self-control. He talked about the coming judgment. He would get apprehensive. "Okay, I don't want to hear that right now. I'll call you when it's more convenient." And every time he called him, I'm sure Paul was urgent. Jesus, he's the way, he's the way, the truth, he's the way to heaven, he's the one we need. He kept hearing this over and over, and he might have said this: "You know what, I'm starting to believe that, but I'm not ready. I'm not ready. I'm not ready. I'm not ready." So it came to a point that he was succeeded by another governor, and so he left. What happened to him after that? Who knows? The Bible doesn't say that part, but I know this: he missed an opportunity to give his life to the Lord when Paul was speaking to him. How many times does that happen in our life when you talk to your sister or your brother? How many times does it happen when you're talking to a cousin? How many times does it happen when you're talking to a coworker or somebody that you know that doesn't know the Lord? You're sharing your faith. They're asking you, "So what do you do? What do you guys believe? What denomination are you?" All these different things. And you're telling them, and their interest is piqued. The Lord is drawing them. And they say, "Oh, I want to do that one day, but I'm not ready right now. I'm not ready right now." Can I tell you, I've heard so many stories where that person never got that second chance. So many times that happened. I've heard stories and stories and stories. God's calling, God's drawing over and over. "Come to me, come to me. I know what you're going through. I know what you're suffering. I know what you've been through. The life has been hard. Life hasn't treated you well. I know that, but I've been with you. Call upon me. I'm here. I'm here. Stop calling the drugs. Stop calling the alcohol. Stop calling your best friend that doesn't know me. Call me." It happens, church. It happens. So much, I don't know how many people you've talked to about your faith and they kind of shut you down. It feels bad, right? They're not shutting you down. They're shutting the Lord down. I want you to know that today. They don't say no to you. They say no to Jesus. Ms. Kenzie, can you come up and start playing? They're not rejecting you, church. They're rejecting the Lord. But it doesn't feel good because we share in his sufferings. If we're to share in his glory, we're going to share in his suffering. It happens today. Can I tell you that people are searching for answers everywhere? People are searching for answers everywhere because something spiritual is happening. This world is falling apart. This world is crazy. You'll hear what people do. People will search for answers in a Buddhist temple. People will go to a Muslim mosque. They'll go to New Age churches and they'll ask the universe. They'll ask all these things for answers, but there's no reply. There's nothing there. They'll go to different altars of worship, of idols and statues and bottles of holy water that they'll be sprinkled on them. They'll go to a crystal ball. They'll read tarot cards. They'll use pyramids. They'll use brass Buddhas. They'll do many things but call Jesus. Why? Why are they so threatened by Jesus? They don't know unless they try. But God is calling them. That's why they have a spiritual calling. They're saying, "Something's going on. I know there's more to life than just me living in this flesh. I know there's more to life than just walking this walk, waking up, going to work, or taking care of the kids, coming home, going to sleep, doing it again over. There's more to it." And God draws them. He's calling them. He's calling them. But how will they know unless you share it? How will they know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life unless you tell them? How will your family know that you're serious unless you live it? Can I tell you, sometimes we want to preach to our family, but we don't live it. We say God is good, Jesus is good, he's good all the time Jesus is good. But the minute we go through a problem, we're back to what we used to do. They don't see us praying. They don't see us worshiping. They don't see us acting Christ-like. What happened? So you're there, your testimony is right in front of them. What do you do in your time of frustration? Do you curse and get angry and yell? What do you do when somebody gets sick? Do you say, I hope they get better? Or do you pray? Do you see these things? We can say how good God is, but how do you allow him to be good in your life if you don't trust him and show he is good? You can say one thing, but your actions speak way louder. Way louder than the curse words you use. Come on. Way louder. Listen, Paul was arrested. If he hadn't been arrested, how would he have got close to the governor? The reason why I say that, because sometimes when you're struggling, sometimes when you're hurting, sometimes when you don't like your situation, you're frustrated. God, why am I going through this? And there's people all of a sudden in your life, like, why are you bothering me with these people? They're annoying. They're so lost. He says, talk to them. Can it be, church, that God allows you to go through that suffering so you could speak to those that are right next to you? In your struggle, you know, when we were broken, we lost it all. I lost my job and we had no more money. I didn't know. All of a sudden, God knocked me off my high horse because I thought, you know what? We will be okay when we have money. Even though I was a believer, God provides, we have money. But when God allowed it to all go away, it was some of the best worship I ever had. Because all I could do was worship. I know Helen and Angel, you know them, and they remember during those times. And it wasn't an easy time. But God is still good. I learned so much. You know what happened when I lost everything? I had to trust Jesus. You know what happened when I finally trusted him? My faith increased. You know what happens when your faith increases? Through God, all things are possible. When you believe that in your heart, you walk confidently. When the next person says, I'm struggling financially, that's all right. Keep seeking God. When somebody says, oh, I don't give my tithes and offerings because I need to have it for my rent or to pay my bills, I'm like, are you kidding me? Why would you hold back from what God has given you? Why would you hold back from what God is doing in your life? God doesn't say, I'm going to hold this money until you trust me. No, he gives it to you and says, now trust me. So many people hold back from what God is doing. They'll hold their what God has given them. And all it says is to the Lord is, why don't you trust me? I've always been there for you. I've never let you down. You might have not liked your circumstance. I've allowed you to test that so you could come to me. I can say that confidently, church, not because I heard it or it's my opinion, because I've been there, right, Helen? Lost everything. I was even going to move. Me and my family were going to move up north in California to a small bedroom that my in-laws were going to let us stay in because I didn't have a job. I had no savings. I had no retirement. I had no cars. Nothing. And God said, trust me. Those were some exciting times because I said, Lord, I don't know how you're going to do it, but I know you're going to do something. And so now when people tell me what their struggle is, I'm like, oh, you're in for a ride. Trust Jesus. Trust Jesus. It's good. When somebody, I try not to smile sometimes, and I say during prayer, when somebody tells me, Pastor, I'm going through this. Oh, man, I'm a modern-day Job. Oh, man, Pastor, you don't understand. And I'm just kind of smiling. I'm like, oh, sorry, I'm not trying to laugh at you. But all I see is a recipe for a miracle. Amen. From the one that can do all things. All you do is trust him. Come on. Amen. It's exciting, church. It's exciting. When you go through trials and struggles, count it all joy. Not because you're going through them, but because who's with you in that journey. Trust him, who he is. Trust him. He's a good God. I'm telling you. Can you imagine what this Roman governor is thinking? Paul's telling him all these things, and he's telling him about righteousness, self-control. You remember, I'm going to read this scripture. It's not going to be up there again. Paul, sending for Paul, they listened as he told them about faith in Jesus Christ. As he reasoned with them about righteousness, self-control, the coming day of judgment, Felix became frightened. You know why? Because he didn't have any of that. I'm not righteous. I don't have self-control. Judgment is coming. What am I going to do? He became frightened and said, go away. That's why people send you away. You tell them righteousness, live for Jesus, self-control, all these things you're looking for. Go away. I'm not going to be judged. Only God could judge me. And he will. Tell him, and he will. When Paul talked about righteousness and self-control, I imagine Felix is saying, no way, not me. How much? What? I guess I'm doomed. Go away. The Bible says he became frightened. Because what does righteousness mean? The righteousness that's required. Righteousness is required. The bad news is none are righteous. In order to know God, you must be righteous. But that's impossible with man. You need Jesus. Come on. A non-believer will hear, you need to be righteous. But it's impossible because none are righteous. Well, how am I to be righteous? You have to know Jesus. Come on. The reason we tell you we have the answer is because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Can I tell you, for this man, he was interested in Christ. I want to hear more about your faith, but now you're scaring me. Go away. Can I tell you, being interested in Jesus and wanting to learn more is not enough. You have to accept who Jesus is as Lord and Savior of your life. You can just say, oh, I love that story about Jesus. He came back from the dead, I hear. That's not enough that you know it. You have to receive him and trust him. And once this, here's the thing, once this righteousness is revealed, oh, come on. Once you share the good news and they've had an opportunity to hear it, righteousness is revealed. Oh, my gosh, good news. Now it's your choice. Now it's your choice. Righteousness. Here's how you receive righteousness. Here's what you need to do. Here's what you need. Accept Jesus, Lord and Savior. Here's what you need to do. Now you've heard it. Oh, now you're. People say, well, what about people in far off countries that never heard the Lord? What about people here in the U.S. who've never been to church and they haven't heard about Jesus? Can it be that's why the Lord tarries? Because I remember as a kid in the 70s hearing about Jesus coming back tomorrow. He's coming back soon. And when I tell people about Jesus now, they go, oh, they've been saying that for years. Billy Graham's been preaching that for years. Tomorrow's not promised to no one. And I said, thank God he didn't come back because I didn't know him. Thank God he didn't know him because I have family members that don't know him yet. Thank God he's tarrying. Thank God he's being patient for our sake. I can tell you right now, without a shadow of a doubt, you know people in your life that don't know Jesus. Amen. Paul was sharing and sharing. He had the urgency to preach the gospel everywhere he went, no matter if it was one, two, or thousands, he preached. No matter the mocking, no matter the suffering, no matter the pain he would go through, he preached Jesus. He said, your sins would be forgiven. There's hope. And the way to heaven is through Jesus for the debt he paid on the cross. And then, here's the thing. Righteousness received. As a believer, when you receive his righteousness, Jesus gives you this gift of salvation. What do you do with it? What do you do with the gift you received? Do you share it or do you hold it back selfishly? The choice is yours in so many ways. First is to acknowledge him as Lord and Savior. Then the choice is yours. What a deal. Our sin for his righteousness. You know what happens when righteousness reproduced means? Lives are changed. So that's just talking about righteousness to Felix. Then he gets into self-control. He's like, oh, forget it. If I don't have righteousness, I for sure don't have self-control. How many can say, no, don't say it. Self-control. Woo. Everywhere you look, there's temptation. Everywhere you look, there's temptation. Especially if you watch TV. I'm so careful. I mean, I get so mad at the TV because you watch, even children's programs will confuse kids. Watching YouTube, well, watching the kids program, and they're going off talking about, what? How did they sneak that in there? They do. Monitor what your kids watch or your grandkids. Watch them. Don't let them just do it by themselves. You see, Felix was a man who didn't have self-control. He was immoral. He cheated his way to the top. He accepted bribes for being a governor. All of these things he needed to do. And now Paul's telling him about righteousness and self-control for the coming judgment. How would he feel? I'll tell you, he was frightened, the Bible says. A lot of times, can I tell you, for the believer in this house, when you live for God and we get comfortable, and we know we don't read the Bible like we used to sometimes. We know when we're not praying. I mean, I don't know when you're praying, unless you're here on Saturday or Wednesday, amen. I don't know that. You know that. But how does it feel when you do less than what you used to do? So many people have asked me that. Man, I want to be back where I was. The light is so dim. I have the light, but it's so dim. It feels not good. What do you need to do to get back? It's your choice. That up there? No. Amen. I thought it was up there. The choice is yours. Self-control. Amen. A relationship with Jesus changes our lives. It gives you strength. It gives you self-control when you make that choice. When you make that choice, Jesus, by myself, I'd have no self-control. I'll tell you the truth. Without Jesus, I have no self-control. I have to be in prayer. I have to read God's word. I have to spend time with you. Y'all help me. I get excited. You know, there are times, I remember when I didn't feel like coming to church on Sunday and last week. No, I'm just kidding. There are times when I'm tired. Can I tell you, I'm tired. And there are times when I want to pray with somebody because they're struggling and I believe with all my heart God's going to move, but when? And they're asking the same question, but I go, in God's time, we know it's perfect. Maybe God, in his time, it's perfect. Maybe he's allowing stuff. And can I tell you, when I pray for people, there are times that I can't sleep because God wants me to pray. Sometimes I'll wake up and immediately I'm thinking of that person's situation and I'm praying. Some of you know what I'm talking about when you have dreams that way. When God wakes you up to pray, to press in. And I'm going to get ready to wrap up right here, because how terrifying to Felix was the judgment. The governor, he had everything in that time. He had everything at that time. And Paul's talking about righteousness, self-control, and the coming judgment. He had everything. But the Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die and then judgment. It was a very important time for Felix as he was getting right there. God was speaking to him right in front of his face, telling him about righteousness, self-control before the coming judgment. I imagine he said, I'm just not ready. Go away, Paul. Go away. Come back. Come back. Come back when I have more time to listen to you. Because I'm really interested in what you're saying, but not right now. Come back later. I'm not ready. I'm going to this party next. You know, I don't know what's going to happen at the party. Come back next time. I'll call you. Have you heard that? I'll call you. Come to church with me. Oh, next week. Come to church. I'll call you. I imagine Felix telling Paul that. I'll call you. Like many of us today. Can you imagine? I need more time. Right now is not convenient for me. I can't go to church because I got so many things to do on Sunday. That's my day to clean, wash clothes, and that's my day to relax. That's my day. All these things, I've heard them all. But you hear a message of salvation and people deny it because they feel like they have more time. I've heard a lot of young people say, oh, that's good for you, older people, because you don't know how much time you have left. So, well, you don't either. I heard so many people tell me, I want to live my life. I want to get drunk like you used to get drunk. I want to run around like you used to run around. I want to get in trouble like you used to get to run around. Can I thank God that he saved me? During those times when I would drive drunk that I didn't get in the crash and kill myself or somebody else. Those times smoking weed and doing all these things or running around with the wrong crowd. Being angry all the time. Being angry all the time and making decisions I wouldn't have made today because I focused on my anger. There's something to be said about that. Thank God I didn't die when those things were happening. I know some of you know, but I didn't make a decision until God took my mom away from me. She made it to 52 years old. Long life, huh? Long life. You see, nobody told me at that time I had to make a decision. Maybe I heard it, maybe I didn't care. Maybe I just responded in anger to people that told me that. Maybe I wasn't ready. Maybe I just wanted to drink and hang out with my friends and run around crazy like a fool. But thank God for His mercy. Thank God for His grace. Because there is righteousness found in Him. There is self-control. Because if there's not self-control, I wouldn't be here today. I wouldn't be here today. I believe that the Bible is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. I believe there's power in the Word of God. I believe there's power in the blood of Jesus. I believe there's power in His name. I believe those things. Why? It's not just my opinion. I didn't just hear about it, but I'm living it. I'm living it, and I see His goodness all around. I see His goodness in you. I don't know everybody in here and what they're going through, but Jesus does. And can I tell you, He's called you for His purpose. Can I tell you, in this life, it's not about you. It's not about us. When you allow the Holy Spirit to come upon you, you realize there's so much more than you. Can I tell you, your family needs you? Can I tell you, the people around you need you? They need to hear the good news. They need to hear that God is alive, that Jesus rose from the dead. They need to hear it. When they refuse you, they don't refuse you. Can I tell you, all these things that God asks us to do, you can't do on your strength. You can't do in your power. And Zechariah 4:6, again, I'm going to read that. Not by might nor by power, but by the Holy Spirit. By the Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. And I'm going to wrap up. I'm going to close. Does anybody know who Paul Harvey is? And now you know the rest of the story? I remember, I used to listen to him every day on the radio. I listen all the time. He just drew me in because he would tell stories, but you wouldn't hear the whole story until he would share the story. And then he would say, and now you know the rest of the story. Some of you young people don't know. I don't know. I'm not that old. Amen. But I remember one time when I heard his story of if I were the devil, and it made me afraid because it's happening today. And this was in 1965 that he shared this message. And so before I close, I just want to share that. I know a lot of people haven't heard of Paul Harvey. He was on the radio, and I would just listen to him to hear what he would say. And I wanted to know more of the story. And then when he shared this story that if I was the devil, tell me and see if you see any correlation today. So can we dim the light somehow in the front so you can see the video? No, we're good. But can we share that, please?
Bye.
I was a devil, I would continue to do what he's doing. Can you see this is 1965, taking God out of schools, corrupting the government, everybody going to a lottery system, all these crazy things back in 1965. And he concludes this saying, if I were the devil, I would just keep doing what I'm doing. Corrupt everything. And I remember hearing that, and I thought it was like, oh, that's kind of happening now. And it's still happening. It's still happening. Do you see how subtle it seems, but how real it is? It's so crazy how that happens, because we tend to believe that. We tend to believe, oh, you know what? We listen to policymakers, we listen to government, and we forget the word of God. Mm-hmm. He said diseases where there's no cure, and all of a sudden we're in a pandemic. Diseases where there's no cure, and all of a sudden fear goes over faith, and all wisdom goes out the door. I wanted to share that today because it's so important for you to know that there is a one true living God. And you may know that already, and God bless you. The reality is we must decide daily who we choose to deny our flesh and pick up our cross and follow Jesus. All of you have a call on your life. All of you have a plan. And I know this. I remember thinking in my life, in my situation, in my past, what I've gone through, I could never be used by God. Everything that I've done in life and the mistakes that I've made, I could never be used by God. And then I heard a pastor say, God doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called. And then my brother said it up here. He said, God will use the simple things to confound the wise. And those things resonated with me in a mind that was so full of deceit, anger, all these things. And I remember as I got saved and I was excited and I wanted to tell people about Jesus and I wanted to go on the streets and have signs. Jesus is hope. He's the answer. You know, repent. You need to be saved right now. Turn away from your sin. Turn away from those things. I remember people would say, oh, you're a Jesus freak. And I said, thank you. I want to be a freak for Jesus. And then my family, some of my cousins would say, you know, call me over and they're like, what's going on? Are you okay? Yeah, I'm okay. Are you sick? What's going on? I said, no. And then one of my cousins laughed. Oh, he's just brainwashed. And I said, hallelujah, because my brain was dirty. Oh, man, I had the filth that ran through my brain. And all of a sudden, Jesus washed it with the blood. Amen. And they said, are you brainwashed? Absolutely, by the blood of Jesus. I remember, I don't think the same way. Now, do I have that sinful nature in me? Paul says we do. But when you get saved, you are no longer a sinner. You're a saint that struggles with sin. Don't ever beat yourself up because you're not perfect. And when you come to the Lord, people get discouraged because they say, yeah, I'm not perfect. Of course you're not. Of course you're not. But I would say this. In all circumstances, in every trial, in every situation that you're in, don't ever take your eyes off the Lord. Focus on him. Trust him. The Bible says that to the prophet Isaiah, to focus on the Lord. Trust him. And he will give you a perfect peace. The perfect peace that you search for. So today, church, it's your choice. Choose this day who you will serve. Think about what makes you delay. Think about the things in your mind right now. Think about work. Think about all these things that get in your way. Think about your children. Because you know what? Your children are watching you and your decisions. So when you choose carefully. Choose today whom you will serve. Do you want your kid growing up and thinking, oh, you know what? We can do whatever we want. Go out and stay out late anytime I want to. Go out and drink and get drunk. Go out and run around and fornicate and get a disease and get all these different things. It's okay. My parents do it. I was that example. My daughter's sitting in the back. She can tell you who I was. Choose this day who you will serve. I'm going to pray, church, and we're just going to ask the Holy Spirit to take over. So if you would you bow your heads and close your eyes in reverence to the Lord? Amen. Praise the Lord. Right when I was going to pray, my battery died. I would say this. This is the day of salvation. Whether you know him or not. The Bible says to deny ourselves daily, pick up your cross daily, and follow Jesus. And some would say, oh, I'm not ready for that, or I don't know about that. I don't know. I don't feel it right now. But no one is promised tomorrow. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, just allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you. Because he loves you. He knows what you've gone through. He knows what you're going through. He knows where you've been. He knows where you are. He knows everything about you. He knows the struggle. He knows the pain. He knows the hurt in your heart. But he says, let me fill your heart with my love and my peace. Let me remove the pain from your mind and fill it with the godly things. I am the way, the truth, and the life, says Jesus. And it's the only way to heaven. So I'll ask this for those in person, those in online. If this is the first time you've heard this call and you've never asked the Lord to come into your heart, and you never asked him to forgive your sins, if that's you, we don't want to embarrass you. We just want to pray with you. We want you to know who he is. Because how do you trust somebody you don't know? You spend time with him and you get to know him. So I pray this right now, and I say this, if that's you, if you feel you're away from God in your heart, you never asked for the forgiveness that's deep down inside. If you've never asked that, I would say, I want to pray with you and ask God just to consume you. It's not committing to a church, it's not committing to a religion, but it is a relationship with Jesus. So if that's you, would you raise your hand? And I don't want to embarrass you. I just want to pray with you. Amen. I want to believe God with you for your situation. Holy Spirit is getting a hold of you right now. He's touching every heart. Maybe you've said that prayer before. Maybe you've said, I'll trust Jesus, or I'll ask for forgiveness. But then all of a sudden life got in the way. And you're just away from God because of all the confusion of the world and all the temptations of life and all these things that happen that are out of your control. But you've received Jesus before, but you just feel you're so away from him. But now you want to connect with him again because you want to start fresh and say, Lord, I need you. You're the answer that I need. You're the hope that I need. You're all things I need, but I want to know you. It all starts the day of salvation. So I would ask this before I move forward. If that's you, if you've said that prayer before, but you want to say it again because you feel you're away from God, you feel like you don't know Jesus, but you want his peace and you want the joy of the Lord, you want his strength, you want his love, you want self-control, you want kindness, and you want those things that only he offers, we'll pray for you. If that's you, you want to just pray that prayer to receive that from the Lord, the gift of the Lord. If that's you, we don't want to embarrass you, but we'll pray with you. Would you raise your hand? Praise God. I believe everyone in here is saved. They know the Lord. And that's my prayer, that you know the Lord. That you know him, you've received him, you've asked him for forgiveness, you are saved, you have eternal life. So let me pray right now, and then we're going to stand to our feet. So, Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit. I thank you, Lord, that you meet us right here every time. Father, you know every person in this place. And I pray, Lord, your blessing upon them. Father, I pray in their situation, whatever it is, if they're struggling, if they're hurting, you would come upon them in a mighty way. You would come upon them in a mighty way, Lord. You would rest on them, and they would feel you, Lord. They would feel a tangible presence of your Spirit. They would know that rest is in you. Oh, Lord, you're moving through this place. Lord, we thank you for meeting us right here. We thank you because you are the one true living God. We thank you for your faithfulness in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace. Oh, Lord, come rest on us tonight, today, this morning. Come rest on us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Can we all rise to our feet as we, amen, we're going to prepare to receive communion. Amen. We do that at every third Sunday of the month, and we want to do that together. We had an offering cup. Amen. If you don't have one, we can pass one to you. The ushers will come by and get you a cup that has the bread, and then it has the juice in there as well. It takes a little time to open that up, so I'll give you some time. I have one here. Amen. Praise the Lord. Can I tell you that during communion, or let me say this before I say communion, Jesus never asked us to remember his birth, but he did ask us to remember his death and resurrection. That is why we receive communion. We receive it as a symbolic act in remembrance of his sacrifice, the price that he paid for every one of us. It's confirmation of the covenant between God and his people. It's for the believer. Those that don't believe, no need to receive the communion. In Matthew 26:26, it says, as they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. And then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, take this and eat it, for this is my body. And he took the cup of wine, gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Amen. John 6:53 says, so Jesus said again, I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you cannot have eternal life within you. That is why it is for the believer. Because when you receive the Lord, you receive salvation, you receive eternal life. And that's why we do this as in remembrance of the covenant between God and his people. Amen. So if you got it open, I'm going to open up mine as well. But we're going to pray over the bread. And I'm going to do that today. And then I'm going to have my brother Oscar come pray over the juice as symbolic of wine. But let me say this. Let me pray, because it's a time of self-reflection and remembrance of who we are. Are we living our lives according to God's will for our lives? Yes, we make mistakes, but do you come to the Lord? If you ever stumble and fall down, get back up. Get back up. The Lord knows. And as a believer in this house, this communion is for you. So let's pray. So Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, for who you are in our lives. And we thank you for your Holy Spirit in this place. We thank you, Lord, as we prepare to receive this bread, Lord, in remembrance of the sacrifice that you made. This represents your body that was beaten and bruised and tortured and sacrificed for all to be forgiven. We thank you, Lord, that you went willingly and gave it all for the ones you love. For every believer in this house, Lord, we do this as you have asked us to receive the body. And we thank you, Lord, for loving us, for doing all that you do, and who you are in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. You can take the bread.
Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for shedding your blood for our sins. Heavenly Father, we just We just thank you for what you endured in that cross. We ask you, Lord, that you continue to bless us. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Take the cup.
Devil's a liar. Praise the Lord. So can we worship the Lord and just ask him to come rest on every person as we spend time in his presence before we dismiss today? In Jesus' name.
As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. So come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. The gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. So come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will feel me. Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will feel me. Feel me, come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you feel me.
Well, this concludes today's message. Thank you, Pastor Rudy, for a powerful word. For those online watching, thank you guys. You guys are dismissed.